Lockjaw's getting a supercharged Duramax. To handle the power, we'll need a specially built Allison transmission. So, we head to ATS. Binks built, protected by AMSOIL, with support from Roadster Shop and Nitto.
Gail Banks here. Like and subscribe for more education and entertainment. All right, let's get to it.
All right, Arvada, Colorado, ATS Diesel. Let's go talk transmissions. Now, we're with Clint Cannon, owner of ATS. Now, Clint, way back in the day when you were like 3 or 4 years old, you started ATS, and it stood for Automotive Transmission
Specialist.
Yes. Okay, so you guys, you know their expertise in turbos and controllers, all sorts of stuff, but really, your roots are in transmissions.
Yeah, that's where everything started, started building transmissions, and then, okay. Of course, started building torque converters, and that's where the triple lock came from. So all the old billet torque converters. That was in 97.
That's you.
Yeah, that was the beginning of it.
Okay.
Yeah, all right. That's where so we had the only triple disc torque converter out there for years.
Tell me you patented it.
I did. Okay, yeah, that's why they square tab today. That's why it's the only square tab converter you'll find is ATS.
Is that true?
Yeah, there's a couple of patents in the five star and the ATS and the triple lock.
Okay.
But you'll notice everybody has a round tab design or some kind of variation, because the square tab, when I patented it, that was basically for the longevity to keep everything from rattle around, keep it quiet.
Okay.
So it just wouldn't wear out. That's also why we have a 5-year warranty. Just because the torque converter takes most of the abuse from the engine torsionals.
Okay.
And when you get rid of all the engine torsionals, get rid of the abuse in the converter, then you don't ever drop metal, you don't have to worry about it. So you don't have contamination dropping into the tranny.
Gotcha.
Because all the oil that's going from the pump through the torque converter, through the cooling system, back in the transmission, right, is lubricating all of it. So if you have any issues with all the multiple clutches inside the torque converter, then it'll contaminate the tranny. So it's kind of twofold. One, you need the multiple clutches to hold all the torque.
Right.
But you also need the longevity so it doesn't beat itself up when you have all those clutches rattling around in there because they're hooked directly to the engine. There was a lot of controversy because back then diesels were just entering the market, and I was automotive transmission specialist, and I was working on, my passion was in the diesels, and I won't name a name, but I had somebody saying, you're killing this company with these diesels. You're killing this company. So anyway, I just kept pushing forward because the diesels are awesome. You know, they just made so much torque, so much power, and we had to couple them inside the transmission, inside the torque converter. Really, the tranny wasn't the big challenge back there. They were only making 400 horsepower.
Right.
You know, maybe 450 on a good day.
Right.
Right. You know, maybe 800 foot-pounds of torque, but it would just absolutely tear up the torque converters. So the torque converters didn't have a chance because this one little clutch that was pressed in against the stock cover. Uh-huh. So, you know, I had to make the cover out of billet, had to make a billet piston, then put clutch packs inside of it, basically just like a motorcycle clutch, right? So you just stack them all up. And that took a lot of work, a lot of equipment, a lot of testing, you know, putting them out in the oil field, over the road, you know, behind bigger horsepower trucks, you know, as they started coming up. So that was kind of those were the formative years of diesel, when everybody started rolling into a diesel truck because it would get the work done.
How did you decide on purple? Where did that come from?
Purple basically came from it was originated because there was nothing else out there that was using it. And I really wanted to distinguish ourselves to make sure that our stuff didn't get confused with somebody else's. So ironically, it kind of started out almost as a pink by accident.
Pink.
So for about the first 6 months, I was trying to figure out what is
diesel.
Oh, it was not cool. So once we finally figured out, the deep purple, that's beautiful. You know, that deep royal purple, and it's just a pretty color. So everything went purple.
Let's go through what you're doing on this particular Allison, how you're making it more stout and able to support the 600 horsepower or 1,000 that we're going to generate with our Duramax.
So we started with, you know, of course we wanted 6 gears. You know, the Allison, when it came out in 2001, had 5 gears. Mm-hmm. It was the same basic tranny. And then in 06, they basically enabled 6 gear, changed some hydraulics. And as the years went on, you know, it was a little bit more refined. So what we're starting with is basically a LML style. So we're going to have 6 speeds. We're going to have the late model valve body,
okay,
which the late model valve body gives us some more control. They kind of went away from the trim valves, which was trimming pressure on the clutch packs. And we have EPC control. So it's a little cleaner, a little easier to work with, but very, very, very defined as far as shift quality. Okay. Get us exactly what we want, late model controller.
Roadster Shop is designing the chassis to fit this. Like this, we're gonna lay frame. I don't know if you know that, but I mean, yep, that's finally. Why it's tragic we can't use your deep pan over here, right? We have to use the shallowest Allison pan.
Well, the reason we're just now getting this build, right, is because we didn't know exactly for sure if we get the Allison in there.
Right.
Right, so now that you know you've built the thing around the Allison, you know, you don't have a lot of room there.
But
it's great. Now that we can run the Allison, you know, the Allison's incredible. You know, the gear selection is ideal. You have the low first gear, you have the high overdrive. You know, so when you have a double overdrive, fifth is overdrive, sixth is overdrive. So it really gets that RPM down there.
And you're not changing anything in your build, correct?
We're not changing the ratios.
Okay.
You know, the ratios are ideal is for what you're looking for. You know, you want that low first gear so you can really get out of the hole. And then as you go up through the gears, you know, you get that double overdrive, so it brings the engine RPM down. You know, the factory Allison's a pretty, it's a really good tranny. I mean, one thing they gave us out of the factory is it's big parts. You know, I mean, the size of the clutch packs, they're huge. You know, these are like twice the size of the clutch packs on most other trannies. Now, what the Allison doesn't give you is it's very low line pressure, and it's basically by the design of it, it's a clutch-to-clutch transmission, so it's basically a non-synchronous tranny. That means a clutch applies, and then when you make the next shift, a clutch has to release, another clutch applies, so you have the computer that's controlling all that via the hydraulics, and then finally, the hard parts is what holds the different planetaries, give you your ratios, and the clutches have to do the work. Well, Allison, they were pretty smart. They built this huge tranny for durability, but they kept it a very low line pressure transmission inside the clutch packs, and that's one of the things that's not really that known even today about the Allison is they will make 300 PSI at the pump, but you only get about 160 PSI in the clutch packs.
Are they doing that for drivability?
They did that one for longevity. They didn't need the line pressure, you know, to the clutch packs because they're only rated to hold maybe 300 horsepower, right? And they'll hold that all day long. Well, as soon as you start getting into that 400, 500, 600, 1,000 horsepower range, then all of a sudden you have to start changing all the shift time and you have to go with more clutches inside of it. So when one of the things we did to upgrade them, first of all, is the hydraulics. So we redesigned the hydraulics with an electronic package that bolts onto it that allows line pressure, the actual line pressure of the pump to get to the clutch packs. So now instead of being limited to around that 160 PSI clamping force, we'll go all the way up to 300 PSI. But we only do that under engine load. So when that engine is making a lot of torque and it needs it, then we'll raise it. You know, when you back off, then we lower it down. And lower it down, what that gives you is less parasitic drag, so you maintain your miles per gallon. You know, you're not so concerned about that, but
right.
I like drivability, and I like to integrate, you know, all the stuff the factory's done that teaches us the longevity and the low line pressure, not sticking to the delivery rings, does not wear out the transmission, let's not build extra heat. We can take that extra volume and push it through the cooler, push it through the converter so it cools it more and it lubricates it. But then when we need it, then we'll divert that line pressure to clamp the clutches down. So that's some of the hydraulic mods. And when you get into the actual heavy duty mods, you take clutch packs instead of three or four clutch packs, you know, we're on six or seven.
Okay.
So every time you add a clutch, which this is basically hooked to the rear wheel, this would be hooked to essentially the engine, right? And as soon as you clamp these together, it becomes one-to-one, right? And when you're unclamped, they're rotating, they're spinning. So you don't want that parasitic drag when they're spinning, so you want to keep them disengaged,
okay.
Otherwise you'll just get a bind-up, right? Well, as you start to increase the amount of clutches, you maximize the size of them. If you can go bigger, we increase the number of them, so we go to a higher, so mechanically, you end up with twice or sometimes three times the mechanical ability to hold the power. That way you don't have to make them shift really hard so the clutches don't glaze. You bring them in at a nice timing index so it gets it just quick enough to where it doesn't break through the oil barrier of the clutch, and then it makes a one-to-one connection. You have a nice smooth shift, but you can do that all the way through the power level. So once you get your clutch application right, so you have as much clutch as you can, you optimize or maximize the line pressure that clamps everything down, then at that point, your weak link becomes parts like the shaft. You know,
wow.
So you might say, that's a huge shaft. I mean,
that's what she said.
Yeah, I mean, that's a massive shaft. This is literally like twice the size of, say, like a little Dodge transmission.
Okay.
Well, when you start getting up there,
700,
800 horsepower, they break. You'll snap them. if you can believe that. You'll literally break the shaft off. So Allison didn't spend a ton of money building shafts out of Airmet or 300M or anything like, because they don't need it. They just put it in the size, right? It's a good size shaft. As soon as you start taking all that slip out and you're hooking up with the rear wheels and you're under power, you know, you're making 1,000, 1,200, 1,500 foot-pounds of torque, you know, at some point, when you're twisting on these things, you're gonna fatigue the shaft, it breaks them. It just breaks them. So really the difference is between, say, your 600, I know one of the concerns was you guys were like, we're only gonna be about 600 horsepower, like, you know, only 600 horsepower, probably, you know, 1,000, 1,500 foot-pounds of torque, right?
Right.
And then there's talks like, what if we somehow ended up at that 1,000 horsepower range? You know, I'm kind of like, no problem.
It's,
you know,
possible. We may do that. Yes, yeah. We're going back and forth right now.
The only difference in our build, because we, with the heavy-duty clutch packs, the big pump, all the hydraulic mods, the electronics, and every single training, whether it's a stage one or a stage six, as you get, I like the stage six, how's that?
Yeah,
as you go up in the stages, we go up in horsepower level. The reason we do that, to save the consumer money, if you're at a 600 horsepower level, you know, engine that you're building, you don't need the expensive billet input shaft. You don't need the expensive billet output shaft. You don't need the expensive hub. You don't need the expensive planet. As we start going up in power levels, then we just basically take out the stock shaft and we put in a nice billet input shaft that's made of 300M. And this breaks first, the hub breaks second, the output shaft breaks third, depending on whether you're sled pulling or just pulling heavy over the road, or a street truck. In your application, with the amount of traction you'll be limited to, the output shaft would probably be the last one that would break.
Right.
On an over-the-road truck, something that's really heavy duty, the output shaft would be the first one to break because they don't slip at all. And they're just, you know, pulling 30 or 40,000 pounds, so you'll just break the output shaft because all that slip is gone. It's either the engine power goes to the rear wheels or it slips in the clutch packs or the converter. If you take all the slip out, at some point, all that power is going to the rear wheels, you're tweaking on the shaft, right?
Sure.
And then you end up breaking it. So what we've done in this application for your truck is we're just building the full build. So it'll be, you know, of course, all the clutch packs, the gear set, and then we're going to upgrade the billet input shaft, we're going to upgrade the hub, upgrade the planet, upgrade the output shaft. And that basically will be a tranny that's good for, you know, 1,200 horsepower. And it'll run all day at that level. I mean, very, very
smooth
strong.
Shifting as well.
Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah, okay. Like I say, drivability is very important.
Okay.
And that is really one of the huge differences that I really see in ATS builds, the way we engineer our stuff versus a lot of the aftermarket world, is we don't just crank up pressure and we don't just drill holes, we don't just get the clutch pack in there really quick, tighten them up. That makes a very firm shift, and it helps you hold power.
Yeah, we're not building a sled pull truck.
Yeah, you can always have drivability, a very smooth, clean shifting transmission, and have it hold power when it's designed right. So, but you have to utilize the right combination between clutch pack upgrades, hydraulic modifications, and electronic control. And those three are key. You can't do it with one of them. You have to hit every part of it. And of course, all these transmissions today, they're all electronically controlled. So the computer is monitoring how fast the input shaft's going, how fast the engine's going, how fast the output's going, and it's calculating that ratio. As soon as it goes to apply a shift, it's looking for that turbine pull down, and there's basically a number, a timing index, that the computer's wanting to hit in order to bring that clutch pack down without hitting so hard that it makes a hard shift. But if it doesn't get it down quick enough, then it slips the clutches. What the manufacturers rely on is derating when they make a shift from first to second or second to third. Then the TCM says, hey, hold on a second, engine, you got to derate the engine. So it basically backs the throttle off, right? It lowers that power down, lets the clutches apply, and then it ramps the power back up. So you get that, you know, that kind of funny shifting.
Right.
That's what all the manufacturers are doing these days to an extent. So the real key is let's give the transmission the ability to hold that power, to pull that engine down and not derate the engine. So you fix the transmission so it can make those gear changes at the higher power levels are really heavy weight behind you, and then it never slips, so the TCM never sends the derate signal, so the engine never has to derate, never powers down.
All right.
So now it's a nice clean transition, first gear, second gear, third gear, fourth gear, and everybody's happy. It's like, ooh, that feels really nice, and it's just a good driving experience.
All right, so when this one is done, you're gonna ship it out to me, we're gonna put it in, then you're gonna fly out and we're gonna do donuts.
That sounds like a hell of a deal.
Donuts and
beer.
I
like doing donuts, yep.
Perfect.
Yep, deal.
All right, thank you. Awesome.
All right, Jay.
In the next episode, the guys head back to Roadster Shop for an update on their Spec Series chassis.
OSHA, don't watch this. All right, bring her up.
Gail Banks here. Like and subscribe for more education and entertainment.